so that the mountains would quake at your presence. Oh, come, Shepherd of Israel, stir up your strength and come to help us. Oh, come, Emmanuel, ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. These are songs of hope, and the refrain replies, rejoice, rejoice, for Emmanuel shall come to you. On this first Sunday of Advent, we celebrate hope, one of the basic emotive and active aspects of our Christian life. Our hope is in the Lord. At first, though, our reading from Isaiah this morning seems rather hopeless. Chapters 63 and 64 of Isaiah reflect a moment in Israel's history, just after the Babylonian exile. You see, the king of Persia has made a decree inviting the people to return to Judah and Jerusalem to begin rebuilding the kingdom. But they found a clash between those returning exiles and those who remained in the land during the period of exile. And there was now power struggles and battles over land and divisions and threats. It is into this context that Isaiah writes this lament to God. Now it begins by praising God for the gracious deeds of the Lord, seemingly reminding God that it was God who saved the people out of slavery in Egypt. But then the tone shifts. For while God was present during the Exodus, visible and spectacular, the divine warrior who victoriously came down to Israel's aid, now, after they have returned to their homeland, God is hidden from their sight. So they cry out in desperation, oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. Three times they cry out for God's presence, and yet still the people cannot see God. Now, according to biblical scholars, God's hiddenness seems to have two purposes for the Israelites. The first is that it actually keeps them from abusing the idea that God belongs to them, or that they can control God. And it also awakens them to the consequences of sin. Well, then Isaiah dances with this idea that God's absence is both a cause of and a result of the people's sin. He writes that God is faithful to those who gladly do right, but points out that Israel has sinned. We have become like one who is unclean, he writes. Our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. Our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. And then he writes this really powerful line in verse 7. No one calls out your name or attempts to take hold of you. The people no longer sought God. The relationship between God and the people is in danger of being too wide to cross, an unbridgeable chasm marked by both God's absence and the people's faults and failings. But just when it seems like all hope is lost, just when that chasm seems too deep and too wide, hope returns. The people reach out, grasping, and call on the name of the Lord. They remind God that they know who God is. Oh Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hands. And they cry out for mercy. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. It's so interesting that what began as a cry for the divine warrior to burst from the heavens ends in a far different place. No longer a call for a cosmic military intervention, God is now an artist, a potter, working and molding and reforming over and over and over again God's broken people. Isaiah calls the people to be malleable in God's hands, while at the same time reminding God of God's promise to form the people into a people of blessing. This is the Advent message, to reach out in times of uncertainty and suffering with an everlasting hope, to take hold of the redeeming, loving God who has come and who will come again. But hope is not a guarantee of instant gratification, is it? I was reminded this week that the root word for hope in Hebrew comes from the same root word for wait. A nice Advent reminder. Hope and waiting go hand in hand. But I learned too that the word for hope in Hebrew also comes from the root word for cord, or rope. Can you picture it? Hope like a rope being thrown to us when we desperately need it. Yes, the hope rope. The hopelessness of no one calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you turns into an active, expectant waiting. Well, earlier this week, I was browsing the variety of Advent devotionals that were coming across my newsfeed, and I came across a young theologian's anti-Advent wreath project. Now, at first, I was hesitant to read it, expecting an oppositional anti-church opinion piece. But what I found was a beautiful reminder that Advent hope is active, faithful, waiting on the Lord. So the Anti-Advent Wreath Project began when Pastor Amy Fiat wanted to dive deeper into the basic themes of Advent, hope and joy, love and peace. She writes, "One day I was sitting with a group of other clergy and I started to wonder about these weekly themes. As much as I know I am in need of hope, love, joy, and peace, I'm not sure if I've come any closer to understanding what they look like. I'm far better at living without them," she admits, "even though I know my soul needs them." That's when she thought to herself, one of the best ways to understand something is to explore its opposite. And so the anti-Advent wreath idea was born, not anti as in oppositional, but anti as in opposite. So in her first week's reflection, she began by looking at the opposite of hope. And at first thought, as I think many of us might go to, she thought hope's opposite would be despair. And yet, as she considered it more, she reflected, when we say despair is the opposite of hope, What we're doing is making hope into an emotion. It also implies that one can't feel both hope and sadness at the same time. She became convinced that hope, while it may include emotion, is not an emotion in itself. Instead, she considers hope a state of being, which refuses to let go of the rope we're holding on to, even if we're only holding on by a thread. But if not despair, then what is the opposite of hope? She suggests resignation. She writes, "Resignation says, why bother? And not because of apathy, but because hope has been deemed too foolish to hold on to. Hope holds on to the rope. Resignation believes the rope is useless. Hope is a posture of holding out open hands, while resignation insists on clenched fists. Resignation believes that things will never get better, and at the same time actively works to ensure that things never do. The Israelites lost sight of God. No one calls out your name or attempts to take hold of you. But they didn't resign themselves to a life without God. They cried out and lamented and pushed through. They were awakened again to their need for God. They moved then to a place of promise and learned to hope again. This Advent, we are invited to hope in the God who comes to us, not as an earth-quaking, water-boiling, fire-kindling warrior to fight against our adversaries, but hidden in human form, to reveal the power of the powerless by giving his life on the cross. And in doing so, God reveals the will of the Almighty Potter, who is eternally, patiently molding and shaping the clay of creation into the new Jerusalem. Oh, come, Emmanuel. Amen.